Okay, I once again welcome you to the 11th session. We have some few sessions to finish this. And this section is titled Selected IGOs. We'll be looking at the World Bank, the International Criminal Court, the African Union, and the European Union. In terms of overview, the session discusses the activities of certain selected IGOs. We'll look at the World Bank, the International Criminal Court, the African Union, and the European Union. The discussions will center on the reasons for the establishment of these organizations and the organs or institutions through which they carry out their activities. In terms of the outline, there are two main topics. The first one will look at the World Bank and the International Criminal Court. The second one will look at the European Union and the African Union. I've made some reading materials. These are very specific if you can have access to them. One is Bosman Asari, International Politics, The Beginner's Guide. The second one is Charles Kegley and Shannon Blanton, World Politics, Trend and Transformation. Now let's move on to topic one, the World Bank and the International Criminal Court. The World Bank was established in 1944 as the International Bank for Reconstruction and Development. The World Bank is widely seen as the second most prominent IGO after the United Nations. The bank is owned by the 187 member countries. So the top management of the bank, at least in theory, promote causes that benefit all the member countries because the bank is for the countries of the world, 187. That means the UN has more members than the World Bank. I know that the slides are very, very explanatory, so I'm going to point out certain key things as far as the World Bank is concerned. The World Bank supports developing countries by giving them low interest loans that they can hardly get in the private market. In the private market, it's very, very expensive. The World Bank supports countries. The bank also gives long-term financial assistance to developing countries. Unlike the IMF is more interested in short-term financial assistance, but the bank is mainly interested in long-term financial assistance. And one thing which is unique about the bank, which I want us to point out, is that the bank has a voting procedure called weighted voting. Both the IMF and the World Bank operate that principle. And that weighted voting means that a country's votes are dependent on the country's financial contribution. So only a country like the USA, they have almost 18% votes as far as the World Bank is concerned, and the whole of Africa is less than 3%. The reason is that your votes are dependent on your financial contributions. I know most of you will say this is unfair, but the point is that those who are giving the money, they have more say than those who are not giving the money. And one thing we also want to say as far as the World Bank is concerned is that there is an unwritten law which says that the president of the bank must always be a U.S. citizen. When we say an unwritten law, in other words, this is a document you cannot pick and say that this is what they are stated. But among the shareholders of the bank, the member countries of the bank, they know that any time the position of president is vacant, it's the U.S. president who will appoint someone to become the president. And usually they appoint people who are U.S. citizens. It doesn't mean others cannot apply. We've been having instances where others from other countries have been applying. But in practice, the U.S. president will normally do the appointment. So the current president of the bank, Dr. Jim Yong Kim, was appointed by the U.S. president, Mr. Barack Obama. Now let's move on. Let's talk about the International Criminal Court. The International Criminal Court has jurisdiction over mass killings, ethnic cleansing, and crimes against humanity. Individuals who engage in mass killings, ethnic cleansing, genocide, these are the people the International Criminal Court will prosecute. So once you do that, the court will make sure that you are prosecuted. The headquarters of the ICC is in The Hague. The Hague is in the Netherlands. We didn't talk about the headquarters of the World Bank, but the World Bank headquarters are in Washington, D.C. Very, very important, just like the IMF. The ICC, unlike other organizations, the numbers are smaller. Now, as we speak now, they have about 123 members. But I want to go straight and look at the various organs of the International Criminal Court. The ICC has the presidency. The presidency has the overall jurisdiction of the court. In other words, the presidency is the wing in charge of the court. And three people make up the presidency: the president of the court, the first vice president, and the second vice president. Then apart from the presidents, you also have the judicial divisions. This is where you have all the judges of the International Criminal Court. They are 18 in all, including the president of the court, the vice president, and the first vice president, and the second vice president. So 18 judges. And the judicial divisions is divided into three. You have the pre-trial division, the trial division, and the appeals division. I said there are 18 judges in all, meaning that six judges are in charge of the pre-trial section. Another six judges in charge of the trial session, and the remaining six judges in charge of the appeal session. In many instances, the president of the court is in charge of the appeals session. Then the next organ is the registry. The registry of the International Criminal Court, they perform the non-judicial functions of the court, like the court registry in Ghana, where you have the registrar of the court. Their main function is to support the other organs of the International Criminal Court. Then the last organ is the office of the prosecutor. The office of the prosecutor, note that I said the presidency of the court has overall jurisdiction, but the office of the prosecutor is completely independent of the presidency of the court. The reason is that the prosecutor is the one who brings the charges against those who have committed crimes against humanity. So once this particular office is not independent of the presidency of the court, we are going to have a problem. That's why in Ghana, for example, those who do the prosecution from the Attorney General's department, they are not under the control of the judges. The system is such that the prosecutors will be independent. The judges will also be independent. And as I said, the registry, they perform the day-to-day function. So they support the office of the prosecutor. They support the judicial divisions. So do they support the presidency of the court. Until recently, a Ghanaian was one of the vice presidents of the court. I remember she used to be the dean of the Faculty of Law. Some of you will know the name Professor Kwia Kwenye here. She used to be, and I know the University of Ghana Law School has been named after her and our former president, Professor Mills. I have some few sample questions for you. What is the principle of weighted voting at the World Bank? Discuss the relevance of the World Bank to Ghana. Describe the functions of the organs of the International Criminal Court. Why is it important for the office of the prosecutor at the ICC to be independent of the presidency of the ICC? Now let's move on to topic two. We want to look at the European Union and the African Union. The European Union, as we speak now, has 28 members. I know most of you are aware that the British people about a month ago voted to leave the European Union through what became known as the Brexit. But as we speak now, Britain is still a member of the European Union, so they still have 28 member countries. And one of the differences between the EU and the other organizations we have discussed is that, unlike the other organization, the EU is more of a regional organization. And apart from being a regional organization, the EU is a typical example of a perfect union. In other words, unlike the other organizations where members appear to see the organization as so remote, the EU has become part and parcel of the domestic activities of the member countries. So for the five theories we discussed, the one which mostly applies to the EU is the federalism. Because federalism argues that there are two levels of government. And in the EU, the member countries see the EU as the central government, and each of the member countries is seen as a state or a provincial government. And you know, the EU also has the currency called the euro. As we speak now, the countries that are using the euro, they are about 19. So I've provided the names. You can see countries like Austria, Belgium, Cyprus, Estonia, Finland, etc. So 19 member countries are using that currency as their official currency. We know Britain is not using it and other countries are not, but 19 of them. So those countries using the euro, the experts call them the Eurozone countries. So once you hear the Eurozone, it means the countries that are using the euro as their official currency. And these are the countries we will be talking about. EU institutions, the European Central Bank plays a major role in these countries. Now I want to look at the main organs or the main institutions of the US. We have what is called the European Council. The European Council is made up of the political heads of the various EU countries. At times, some experts call them the European Summit. These are the political leaders. And their main job is to provide the political direction, the policy direction of the European Union. So if they think that the EU should be looking like this in the next 5 years, these are the people who do it. So the Chancellor of Germany, the Prime Minister of Britain, the Prime Minister of Italy, of Netherlands, the main countries, the President of France, they come together to form the European Council. Then we also have the Council of the European Union. Don't be confused. European Council is different from the Council of the European Union. The Council of the European Union, which is also called the Council or the Council of Ministers, is made up of all the ministers of the member countries. All the ministers in Britain, ministers in Italy, in Germany, they form the Council of the European Union. And this is how they work. If the issue they are talking about is education, all the ministers of education will come together. If what they are talking about is energy, all the ministers of energy will come together. If it has something to do with women empowerment, all those in charge of women empowerment in the various countries will come together. You can see some of their functions have been identified. They assist the European Parliament in passing the laws. They do several things. And one thing which we also have to emphasize is that they are responsible for implementing EU policies in their countries. So when they attend meetings and the EU says that now all of us want to ban smoking in our countries, those ministers involved, it is their job to go back to their countries to ensure that smoking is banned in their countries. Now let's talk about another organ that has to do with the European Commission, perhaps the most important organ of the EU. The European Commission is the executive organ of the European Union. It's responsible for the day-to-day administration of the European Union. Don't forget, we said the EU has 28 member countries. Of the 28, each country has provided one commissioner. So in all, there are 28 commissioners, some responsible for education, some in charge of foreign policy, some in charge of energy issues. So each country has one commissioner. And as I said, it is the executive wing of the European Union. So in Ghana, the functions that are performed by the executive branch of government, when you go to the EU, they have the huge bureaucracy. The commissioner is there, and there are individuals who are working under the commissioner to prosecute the agenda of that particular commission. Now, we also have the European Parliament. The European Parliament, as the name implies, is solely about lawmaking. The capital of the European Union is Brussels in Belgium. But one thing they've done in Europe is that some institutions are located in certain countries. So European Parliament, for example, they operate from Strasbourg in France. Mostly they are in Strasbourg, although they also operate from the national capital. Then you also have the Court of Justice of the European Union. This is the court that settles disputes between member countries. At times, they settle disputes between individuals and member countries. At times, between business organizations and member countries. And this court operates from Luxembourg City. Luxembourg is one of the smallest countries in the European Union with about 500,000 or so people. Now, the next entity or organ is the European Central Bank, which is located in Frankfurt in Germany. And as a central bank, they are mainly responsible for monetary policy. Monetary policy basically has to do with policies to control the supply of money so that we don't have problems like inflation, stagflation. I hope you know inflation basically has to do with when prices of goods and services are going up. Stagflation is the extreme form of inflation. Then we have unemployment. Unemployment, as a Ghanaian, you are familiar with it. So the job of the central bank is to ensure that they manage the supply of money, they control the supply of money in the system so that you don't have problems with inflation, stagflation, or the different economic-related problems. And the bank also maintains the purchasing power of the euro and price stability. Here, what they basically do is to ensure that the purchasing power of the euro is such that it does not undermine the confidence of investors. It will still encourage people to come and invest. It will encourage people to export their goods, their services to other countries. Now we can also look at the African Union. Unlike the European Union, the African Union is a work in progress. So you can see the African Union was formed in 2001 after calls by several African leaders for a more perfect union. Because before the African Union was set up, we had the Organization of African unity, which was more about the independence of the African continent. But an African Union is talking about what can we do so that we may approach the levels of the European Union. Now let's talk about some of the African Union institutions. The Assembly of the Union, this comprises the political heads of the various member countries, the presidents, the prime ministers of the countries. Then you have the Executive Council of Ministers. This organ is made up of the various ministers of the various member countries, just like the Council of the European Union. Apart from this, African Union has other organs like the Pan-African Parliament, which is located in South Africa, Peace and Security Council, the Economic, Social, Cultural Council. There are many other organs, but as I stated initially, the African Union is still a work in progress. So there are many things which are still being developed to make the organization or to make the union very productive in the affairs of the member countries. Now let's look at some sample questions. What are the key institutions of the African Union? Describe the main organs of the European Union. Distinguish between the European Council and the Council of the European Union. In terms of conclusion, in this session you have been introduced to four intergovernmental organizations, notably the World Bank, the International Criminal Court, the European Union, and the African Union. Now you should be in a position to explain to others the various organs of this IGOs and the reasons for their establishment as well as their functions in the international system. Some reading materials have been made available. The last one, for example, is available online for download for free. The other two materials too are available online, some in the bookshop for you to buy. Thank you for your cooperation.